This year marks the 20th anniversary of the 4th World Conference on Women and the landmark Beijing Declaration and Platform for Action. Considered the most comprehensive blueprint on advancing women's rights, the 1995 Beijing Roadmap was adopted by 189 governments. But 20 years on, what has been in the achievement of Ghana concerning the Beijing Declaration? Speaking at a sectional ministerial meeting of the United Nations 59 Commission on the Status of Women on the topic, Ensuring the Emerging Leadership of African Young Women and Girls Towards 2063, the President of the West African Ministers for Social Development, Nana Oyelata, who is also the Minister for Gender, Children and Social Protection, said, "Achieving gender equality and women's empowerment is not just human rights, but a vital component of sustainable development."
The 59th session of the CSW is momentous in a number of respects. In 2015, we have reached the target year for achieving the Millennium Development Goals.
Nana Oyelata said, "The Ebola outbreak has caused so much humanitarian disaster, displaced many people and created a wave of orphans, and also negatively impacted the economic fortunes of affected countries and the sub-region as a whole."
WHO states that the impact of the Ebola crisis goes beyond morbidity and mortality. This outbreak is having a significant impact on the economy and people's livelihoods across the sub-region, especially in the rural areas.
Whilst at New York to attend the 59th session of the Commission on the Status of Women, the Gender Minister, Nana Oyelata, had a closed-door meeting with the Executive Director of the United Nations Women Directorate. The meeting seeks to strengthen and open new doors for Ghana and United Nations women to collaborate for achievement of Agenda 2030.
Very grateful you've turned out in your numbers to listen to the success story of Ghana's national women's machinery and also our challenges and prospects. We're very grateful. Ghana was actually one of the first countries to establish a national women's machinery, and we are 40 years. Our national women's machinery was created on the 20th of February 1975, and this was in response to the United Nations General Assembly Resolution 961 that called on member states to establish national women's machinery. It was inspired by the declaration of the 1975 as the International Women's Year. We have certain critical laws that protect women in Ghana. The Interstate Succession Law on Inheritance Rights for Women. We also have the Customary Marriage Laws, which codified registration of customary marriages and divorces. We've extended social protection and ensure that women are considered and are factored into programs of social protection of Ghana. With the support of UNICEF, we have launched a campaign against child marriage. Now we come to our challenges. The socio-cultural influences still plague us and impede our progress in ensuring that women's rights are protected, are realized, and then also women are able to exercise. We also have inadequate resources. Less than 1% of government resources goes into our ministry. Then gender budgeting is still an issue for us in terms of making sure that even the local government budgets adequately reflect and address gender equality. We have issues with enforcing existing laws that criminalize cultural practices. These are some of the challenges we face, and I'm sure the other speakers will speak on their perspectives. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
We've seen that journey from the National Council for Women's Development to the Ministry of Women. One thing that we really appreciate is your emphasis on implementation of the framework. Now, please allow me to invite Honorable Ladi Ayamba, Chairperson of the Parliamentary Select Committee on Gender, to share with us. Thank you.
The Parliament of Ghana, as we know, is a legislative body, and we have always made sure that with laws, especially when it comes to women, we put in our effort. One of the things that we have enjoyed in Parliament is that we have a women caucus in Parliament. With the women caucus, we do not have anything like a party or a representation from any party. All women of Parliament are part of the caucus. So we do not discriminate. This is to enable us to have a forward march.
The gender issue must be pushed, and must be pushed very strongly. In terms of legislation side, I think one of the things we need to do is also to elevate the issue, a lot of the laws to the level of the regional economic cooperation. For instance, FGM, CEFM are things that must be taken up at the ECOWAS level. And I'm happy that our minister is also chairing the ECOWAS Committee of Ministers. So that if CEFM or FGM is criminal in Ghana, it should be criminal in Togo and in Burkina Faso. So you cannot just cross the borders and go and commit the crime. After years, we've done a lot of the hard hitting. Maybe we should change our strategy. I think the message should be more aspirational than accusatory. So rather than saying that we want this, we should also start explaining why we want it. Why do we need gender equality? And it's because gender equality is good for everybody, not just for women.
There is no need for the poverty or at the state that you're in. It's how how do the community, I'm talking about your sons, your husbands, your brothers, can share those natural resources for sustainable and economic development for Mother Africa. And you can make that happen as mothers, as queen mothers of the continent of Mother Africa. And that's what I leave for it with you for the future of our children yet unborn. And I thank you.
If you notice the whole world, how many years we get to, it's only 2085, we'll be able to achieve parity if we go continue like this. That's what they said. Now, if you look at it, until we pierce the party politics, parliament, through the way our grandmothers organize mobilization, I like what you are doing, you know, say, fill the parliament. From there, party feeds parliament. And parliament really feeds executive and judiciary. Until we are there, we can't make it. But we vote for men, and when they come mobilize, when they need voting, they don't come to me, Regina Educated, or to you. They get the women in villages to vote. When they finish, they take them away and make me minister, and tomorrow they can get rid of me. So I'm a loser, my sister is a loser. Well, I want us to really come together and do that. And that's the only thing I wanted to say, because you have everything in place, but please look at how we penetrate party politics and parliament. Thank you very much.
I want to thank Ghana for the role they've played so far in the fight against Ebola in our country through the leadership of the president of ECOWAS. You know, because I was there when he went to Sierra Leone, when he told my president that, look, if other countries have isolated you people, I as chairman of ECOWAS will not isolate you. And that is why I have come here as a sign of solidarity under the ECOWAS and the MRU issues. So all I will say, I hope and pray that I'm glad that UN Women is here. You see, yes indeed, our budgets are very low. You know, only that when my sister said they were like about 1%, so I turned to my director of gender. I said, hold on, I think we are better than me. 1%. But on a more serious note, I am one person that believes that there are resources out there. And I will plead, Mr. MC, I really want the UN Women to hear this, please. I'm pleading with the UN Women to take leadership of the gender agenda.
So it's upon us to encourage more men, because whatever we are trying to do for the girls, especially our adolescent girls, the men have to understand and they have to accept it so that our girls can achieve. But
Let me say to members of parliament, members of civil society, I'm very pleased to see the kind of level of work that's being done with the Minister of Gender, Children and Social Protection from Ghana. This is what we talk about when you talk about collaboration. You have the three branches of government, but one cannot function without the other. And civil society has a big role to play. And as we look at not just government, but let us look at the private sector too when we talk about gender equality. We've left the private sector out, especially in our national action plan. We need to now start including the private sectors. Women not need to go to parliament, but they need to be CEOs. They need to be head of all our oil companies. They need to be head of our universities. They need to be just not elected officials and ministers, but beyond that. Thank you, Ghana.
How do we ensure that women, that governments invest in women in adequate amounts commensurate with women's potential contribution to the economy, the cost of the gender gap, and the right of women to development? Mm. Thank you very much for the fact that you are thinking of working beyond your borders. It is really very important for us to sustain our development. You've mentioned the importance of engagement with private sector and also engagement with traditional and religious leaders. Ladies and gentlemen, Africa is rising, but it will not stay at the top. It will not remain a dynamic force in the global arena as we talk about in Vision 2063 unless women are respected and unless Africa invests in its women and youth. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ghanaian Dream 2030.